He's a highly sought after presenter, and we are incredibly privileged to be hosting him here today, not just to learn about his life story, but also to be inspired and for us to give a very, very small token of hakarat hatov, of thanks and appreciation. Because people like Mr. Webb are the reasons why we're able to sit here in our not just surviving Jewish community, but our thriving Jewish community, and have a Jewish education and pass it along to the next generation. So it's a tremendous honor to welcome you, Mr. Webb. We so appreciate your time, and we look forward to hearing your remarks. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I'm one Holocaust survivor left in this world. For surviving 18 camps over 5 years. I'm trying to bring you up from the time when the war started, when Hitler walked into the city where I was raised. And I will never forget, never think if I'm going to speak to you today, is not actually what wrote books, just everything of that I'm going to say to you today, I have seen with my own eyes. I touch with my own hands certain things. So this is the reason it's my biggest joy to be here to talk to you about it, about my life. Many people ask me, my age is 98, and I'm here. By surviving so many camps, many people asking how does it happen. I am sure some people will ask. I will answer you later, whatever I can. And I try to do my best. If I say I have no written speeches, I never write speeches. I always speak as you see me here, and there I am. I will start a little bit more. In 1939, this time actually Hitler walked into the city where I was raised, was asking nothing, and it was really a Hitler war. We have many wars in my lifetime. I was born in the Second World War, 1917. So when he started, nobody in the city where I was raised, it was a very Jewish city, the second biggest city in Poland. And it was a big percentage in the city where I was raised with Jewish people. Everybody couldn't believe it. And we didn't dream about it. That what is going to be a Hitler war. His plan was to do whatever is Jewish people in the world to clean up. This was his plan. Immediately, in a very short time, what he started to do, the Jewish people couldn't go to the city because what he made it, immediately like a curfew time. Jewish people couldn't walk in the streets. They have to walk, when they walk somebody, they caught everybody. Everybody was afraid to go out. It's very difficult to explain for you or many other people, maybe younger than I am, what that means, what Hitler started, what that means the Hitler war, and how it is. Right away, on a Saturday morning, I got up, people got up. We have been afraid to go out to the city. If somebody went to the city, got caught, should cleaning the streets. You don't have to forget that in those years, like City of Lodz, was not like we're having today. We're having water in the house, we have things. We haven't got those things. The first thing what he did, we have actually the most gorgeous synagogues and yeshivas and Jewish libraries in the city of Lodz. Before you turn around, we have seen a lot of big smoke. It started to burn. Every synagogue, the Jewish books, I mean the Torahs, everything, was burning. Nothing what we can do. That's what was happening. When I have seen just 2 weeks later, he came. I lived not far away from the big hospital. He came in with the truck, and I found myself a spot. What is he going to do, this hospital? With soldiers, backed up a big truck, and went into the hospital. When he went into the hospital, went in every room. This particular hospital was very close where I used to live, maybe 5 minutes to walk. They went in every room and checked it. It was most Jewish people there. Children would have been born a day or two or eight, whatever it was happening. Took away the children from the parents, opened the windows, knocked it against the wall, the little child. He threw them down to the truck. I stayed there. I couldn't scream. I couldn't cry. My tears have been frozen. What do you do? Finally, I said, Mother, I can tell you one thing. If I'm going out to the house now, I don't know if you see me back or if I will be back. Just what I will do, when the time comes, I will sacrifice everything, and I don't think that I will fight for survival. In the meantime, many with the younger people, older people, they showed it, they have been slaughtered. Later on, it took a few weeks, they sent us away to certain factories to work in certain things. So we have no choice, here we are. I started later to send me away by working on the railroads. It's very difficult to explain how it was, the work with food, whatever it is. So somewhere, somehow, I said it one thing. I believe in God and I believe in miracles. As I'm staying here, my life is just a miracle. I couldn't believe it, that will happen. Later on, starting to send me in slave labor camps. I was in 12 slave labor camps. Later on, in a few years, they shipped us in 1943. I was shipped to Auschwitz-Birkenau. And I'm coming there to Auschwitz. We didn't know there's a crematorium. So when we came with a group, actually, in the cattle cars, so many people plugged in. When we arrived on the place, so many dead ones we took out by being actually in the cattle car 2 or 3 days. No food, no nothing. So they took the way with trucks, right away to the crematorium, because we didn't know where to take him. The people that remained, we had to walk to the camp. And they changed the clothes, took the way, and they gave me a number, but I carry it until today. It's my pride, and this was no name. As a matter of fact, it took me a time after liberation, couldn't remember my name, whatever it was. Anyhow, so I have seen how they slaughtered the children, how they slaughtered people hanging in the streets. This was 1940 already, 41, 42. 43, we took action with all the camps, what is left. They shipped us to Auschwitz. So there was this biggest selection. Many people died on the road. Many people have been killed. Certain people, what we had to do in the morning, about being in Auschwitz-Birkenau, in the morning, barracks was like horse barracks. There was no blankets. Sitting, maybe you have seen in movies or something, that people have been sitting like three in a row, six, you know, packed in like herring in a bottle. And then we came to a camp, it was the dead march. What was left was 60,000 people, and took actually on the march. And we have got every night, that took us to a place that couldn't march in the daytime. Next day in the morning, in every place we have been 60,000, but every time less and less. And 60,000 people, after marching two weeks, we have been left 1,100. I was between the 1,100. To be honest, you'll ask me, how have you done it? I built in my mind actually what I promised to my mother. And I was a younger man, so I survived. How I have done it, it's impossible to explain, whatever it is. Finally, in 1945, 8 o'clock in the morning, the Russians came closer. We have been liberated by the Russians. So the Germans opened the doors, and they ran away. And I said to myself, thinking, I'm a man from the ashes. I'm here alive. I will try to do again everything what I promised as a survivor, and to survive, and to start to do a new life. We believed, and I believed myself, very strong. I believed in God, and I never forgot what my mother told me, only God can help you. God helped me. I'm here talking to you. What was happening? A little bit of a Hitler war. So in the meantime, he did not succeed. I'm here. He is dead. I am alive. How I made it? I made it somehow. So I'm here. Thank you, and God bless you all for being here.
The determination. If you're very determined, you want to live. You succeed. When I was in camp, I said to myself 100 times, I don't know how I will survive, but I will survive. I was determined to survive. And determination is the very point in life. You know, you got to be determined what you want to do in your life. And if you're very determined, you'll succeed.